Both the American-led Artemis program and the Chinese-led International Lunar Research Station are planning on establishing bases near the lunar South Pole. Unfortunately, all the key resources and locations are within a very small geographical region, perhaps only tens of kilometers from each other. With no rules or agreements, it's the Wild West on the moon, anything can happen. This sets up a clash, as possessing these locations and resources is critical for maintaining a permanent lunar presence in the region. The Artemis Accords, signed by the US and over 60 other nations, introduced the concept of safety zones around operating assets. China and Russia are not signatories and are developing their own partnership guidelines, which are unlikely to be compatible. There is currently no bilateral or multilateral mechanism forcing the US and China to communicate with each other over locations or resource extraction. Dust and debris from a lunar lander from one nation could contaminate scientific sites or ice deposits kilometers away. If both programs arrive within a few years of each other, proximity operations are inevitable, with disturbances potentially sparking a standoff or even conflict. In this video, I'll go over the constraints that limit site selection in the Lunar South Pole region to a limited number of key locations that both the US and China will be keen to acquire and control. Requirements for a base camp. A key decision for the Artemis project is the base camp location. Let's look at the factors driving this decision. Near constant sunlight. Solar power will be the main source of power, at least in the beginning. Later on, both programs intend to use nuclear power. The sun barely gets above the horizon, reaching a maximum of 5 degrees in some key locations, and as little as 1.5 degrees at Shackleton Crater. This means solar power arrays need to be placed at high enough locations to capture sunlight consistently. NASA is aiming for solar illumination at least 80% of the time, and in winter over 90% of the time. This is a huge constraint on site selection. Extractable lunar resources. Lunar water ice is suspected of being present in permanently shadowed regions, or PSRs for short. The base camp needs to be located within 5 kilometers of craters with extractable resources which are easy to access. Craters such as Shackleton, Haworth and others meet this criteria. Flat or easily traversable terrain. Flat terrain or with low slopes makes it easy to move around on the moon's surface. Slopes should be less than 10 degrees and, ideally, under 5 degrees. Over 100 meter by 100 meter landing ellipse. Boulder density needs to be low to keep the probability of causing damage to a landing craft to below 2%. Unfortunately, this rules out some of the best illuminated sites, which are on steep crater rims inaccessible for landers or rovers. Rover access to craters and science targets. It's no use landing near scientifically valuable sites if they cannot be accessed because of steep slopes. For realistic access, continuous slopes need to be below 15 to 20 degrees. It's noteworthy that Astrolab recently announced their lunar terrain vehicle can handle 26 degree slopes, but that seems risky. Dynamic stability is lost due to low friction at around 20 to 22 degrees. The figure they quote seems to be peak capability under ideal conditions and unlikely to be realistic for unprepared surfaces on the moon. Thermal environment. A base camp should be situated in an area not subject to extreme temperature swings. Sites with high solar illumination above 80% typically have reduced temperature differences between night and day, with the lowest temperature around minus 50 degrees Celsius rising to plus 70 degrees Celsius during the lunar day. This reduces energy costs to keep habitats and equipment at optimum operating temperatures. High ground. For communications and situational awareness, high ground is preferred. There is at least one location that gives a total overview of the Lunar South Pole region. More on that later. High ground makes it easy to communicate with Earth because of direct line of sight. This allows communication with astronauts in craters from Earth using the high ground comms as a relay. Safety zones, international de-confliction, emerging factor. Distance from other nations' landing sites or operating assets would be beneficial to reduce the chances of accidental damage to assets causing tension or conflict. Moonquakes, emerging factor. Moonquakes are not a key constraint for site selection, but that's because NASA doesn't have enough information to assess the risk. For a sustainable return to the moon, seismic activity is important, as billions of dollars will be spent to construct lunar infrastructure. The Apollo-era missions provided valuable information on moonquakes, but they were focused on the equatorial regions. As can be seen from the graphic, moonquakes do occur near potential base camp locations. The yellow areas represent peak ground acceleration, indicating where the ground shakes the most. Strong to moderate shaking poses risks to landers, habitats, and equipment. Models predict strong shaking could extend to over 40 km distance from faults, potentially destabilizing tall assets such as SpaceX's Starship, lunar mass, or vertical solar panels. The Artemis 3 mission will drill a borehole and place a range of instruments to monitor moonquakes for between 3 months and 2 years. Moonquakes are a risk factor for long-term infrastructure, but not short missions, such as the Artemis 3 mission, which is scheduled for only 6.5 days on the moon. These combined factors eliminate 99% of the South Pole region. Now we know the constraints, let's look at the key locations that both the US and Chinese programs will target. Key locations near the lunar South Pole. Shackleton de Gerlache Connecting Ridge. This location has solar illumination 92% of the time and gentle slopes allowing easy access to multiple nearby craters. It is one of the top locations for a long-term base. China has publicly stated that Chang'e 7, launching next year, will target the illuminated rim of Shackleton Crater, a site that directly overlaps this site. If NASA were to choose this site, the chances of conflict or tension with China will be high. Peaks of Eternal Light, or PELs. These locations, which have solar illumination at least 80% of the time, are crucial because solar power will be essential for many years until nuclear reactors come online. True peaks of eternal light are locations with sunlight over 90% of the time. Only 4 such locations are known. The first true PEL is a small peak on the rim of Shackleton. The second is a connecting ridge section just discussed. The third is on Malapert Massif. And the last location is a small peak on the rim of Haworth Crater. These are the only 4 places on the entire moon where solar power generation is possible nearly continuously throughout the lunar year. Controlling these locations gives a huge advantage over rivals. Malapert Mountain Area. This location is perfect for setting up communication antennas for direct links to Earth. In addition, it has excellent illumination and relative gentle slopes. Malapert is approximately 5 to 6 kilometers above the surrounding terrain. From the summit, the Earth is visible 95 to 98% of the year. In contrast, the rim of Shackleton Crater, or the connecting ridge, has Earth visibility blocked 20 to 40% of each month. From this location, nearly all of the lunar South Pole can be seen, allowing communications with astronauts and equipment in craters. This is high ground in the lunar South Pole region and important to hold to avoid any surprises from rival nations. China's plan explicitly mentions Malapert as a candidate relay node for the same reason. Malapert is 120 kilometers from Shackleton, so will likely not be a base camp, but will be an outpost used mainly for communication. Both NASA and the Chinese Space Agency consider this location a top priority and a key strategic location. Mons Mouton Plateau. Mons Mouton lies southwest of Malapert and has a flat, triangular plateau with 89% average illumination. It was added to NASA's 2024 shortlist for site selection. It's a great location for a large solar farm or potentially a lunar base. The flat plateau is 100 kilometers long, rising 6 kilometers above the surrounding terrain. Let's now turn to a key mission for China, Chang'e 7. Chang'e 7, China's key mission for lunar South Pole selection. Chang'e 7, an 8-ton lunar lander, launching to the lunar South Pole in August 2026, is hunting for good locations for its future lunar base and to find key lunar resources that can be extracted. The preferred site is a permanently illuminated peak next to Shackleton Crater with backup sites nearby. The Chang'e 7 mission features an orbiter, a lander, a rover, and a mini flying hopper. In addition to the lander, it will be supported by a relay satellite in orbit around the moon. 15 instruments are on board across the orbiter, lander, rover, and hopper. The small hopper will jump into a permanently shadowed region, likely Shackleton Crater, to look for lunar water ice using his only onboard instrument. This instrument measures the amount of water in the lunar soil. Chang'e 7 is planned to be operational for 8 years, with Chang'e 3 currently in its 12th year of activity and Chang'e 4 approaching its 7th year, triggering events that could lead to a clash. Let's speculate about events that would cause tension that could lead to a clash between the two sides. Debris damage caused by lunar lander operations. The technical term is plume surface interaction, or in more common terms, massive rocket engines blasting regolith in all directions at high speeds. With no atmosphere to slow down the ejector, it can reach speeds of 1 to 2 kilometers per second. Anything in its path will likely be obliterated. Safety zone overlap and trespassing. What happens when a rover from one mission strays into an area operated by the other side? Is that trespass? Well, no, because there are no rules on the moon. Assets from one side could cause interference, radio or electromagnetic, with assets or communication systems on the other side. Even if unintentional, it could lead to retaliatory measures, including orbital blockade or relay satellites or other measures. Disputes over resource extraction. The reasons the two missions are heading towards the lunar South Pole is to extract resources, especially lunar water ice. First mover advantage could be important. Establishing a presence could allow that side to claim a safety zone around the resources to exclude the other side, you know, for safety reasons. Placing a nuclear reactor near the resources provides a good reason to exclude other parties. What happens when one side fences off resources? Weaponizing lunar water ice, a key source of propellants, would likely lead to retaliation from the other side. Orbital and communication interference. Key locations such as Malapert and Mons Mouton represent the high ground, providing situational awareness for the whole of the South Pole region. Acquiring and holding this region is critical for a long-term presence for this region. Signal jamming or frequency overlaps could be established here, blocking the other side from communicating with its assets. S and X band frequencies are overcrowded already. Any misaligned antenna could cause interference with the communications of the other side. Squatting on a key location. China could opportunistically sit on a key location even if it hasn't developed the equipment to operate there. For instance, the rim of Shackleton Crater or the connecting ridge, key locations and likely base camp sites. Any Chinese assets at these sites would complicate Artemis base camp preparation, either through blocking sunlight or interference in communications. Environmental accidents. Accidental releases of contaminants, either physical or electromagnetic interference, could impede or affect the other side. One side running over a power cable, for instance, or hitting a piece of equipment or asset by accident. All of these types of mishaps or incidents could cause tension, especially if the other side doesn't believe it was by accident. Final thoughts. The lunar South Pole, with its precious water ice deposits and near-constant sunlight locations, is primed for friction between the US-led and Chinese-led missions. Between these two projects, over 80 nations are signed up, as both sides attempt to secure crucial land and resources before the other side gets there first. All the action will take place over a 200 km by 200 km region centered on the lunar South Pole. The moon is the Wild West with no rules. Each party can do whatever they want. Add geopolitical tension and innocent mishaps can quickly escalate into full-blown conflict. Whoever wins in this new space race gains an enormous long-term advantage. Do you think the lunar South Pole is a powder keg? Do you expect conflict as the US and China attempt to take and hold land and resources? Leave your thoughts and opinions in the comments section below. Thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this space video, consider buying me a coffee to help fund more episodes like this. The link is in the description. Space News Live is on Saturday evening or Sunday morning, depending where you watch from. The live stream is a great way for you to share your thoughts and opinions on the videos I posted this week, or on any space topic in general. I highlight the most thought-provoking comments on videos I've received, along with previews of upcoming content. If you got the time, please tune in and say hi. Be sure to like and subscribe so you'll see our upcoming videos. We make videos every week covering the space industry, with an emphasis on the smaller space startups that aren't covered so well on other channels. See you soon.